In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. My Lord and my God, I firmly believe that you are here, that you see me, that you hear me. I adore you with profound reverence. I ask you pardon for my sins and the grace to spend this time of prayer fruitfully. My Immaculate Mother, Saint Joseph, my Father and Lord, my guardian angel, intercede for me. As for me, in justice, I shall behold your face. I shall be filled with the vision of your glory, O Lord. The entrance antiphon of today's Mass sets the theme of the liturgy of the 15th Sunday of Ordinary Time. Hunger for God is instilled in the human heart from the beginning of his constitution, of his being fashioned from the slime of the earth. There is, or there was, and there is, in human nature, in the heart of men, that longing for the infinite, that longing for the greatest good, which in the long run is going to be really our saving grace, so to speak. No matter how off a person may get from the track, that hunger, that longing will be like a toothache in his heart that will prevent him really, unless he deliberately shuts it down, from just getting by. There's always something better. There's always something greater. There's also always something more beautiful that the human heart is hungry for. And that's why St. Augustine, in the maturity of his life, would say that. After having spent a greater part of his life in profligate living as a patrician, a person with all means, trying out all the adventures and all the pleasures of the flesh, even, would say that I searched for you outside when all the time you were inside. My soul is restless until it rests in thee. Or really, that, shall we say, cry of regret. Lately have I known you, my God, lately have I known you. Well, we need to be contemplatives to see it. And then we have to correspond to the Spirit of God stirring in our soul and to follow him to the end, despite all possible faults along the way. This conviction is reiterated in the collect of the Mass when the community cries out, O God, who show the light of your truth to those who go astray so that they may return to the right path. Give all who for the faith they profess are accounted Christians the grace to reject whatever is contrary to the name of Christ and to strive after all that does it honor. All of this is underpinned by the first reading of the Mass taken from the book of Deuteronomy. Recall the setting of this last book of the Pentateuch. It was the final year of the 40-year pilgrimage of the chosen people from Egypt across the Sinai Peninsula to the Promised Land. And the chosen people, at that part of the journey, the end of it already, were encamped at Moab, that high place at the border of Jordan that falls in veritable cliffs to the Jordan River below, across which one could see, first of all, the city of Jericho, the walled city, which is like an emerald in all that dust, brown dust, chocolate color landscape of the Judean wilderness, arid limestones. And it was there like a jewel. It's the oldest city, 7,000 years old. Precisely because it's an oasis. And then towards the left, you can see the horizon, almost the Dead Sea. And if you look towards the right beyond, then you will see the hill country of Judea, where Jerusalem is, and Ein Karim, and Bethlehem. And that was what Moses and the Israelites were looking at as they encamped for the last time before crossing the Jordan into the Promised Land. In that, shall we say, promontory, in that rest, in that final encampment, Moses is speaking to the multitudes. He gives them a recapitulation of what had been going on for the past 40 years, and as a matter of fact, what had been going on since the fall of man. Moses recapped all the events that he had been inspired by God to tell them, later written in the book of Genesis, and all the events of their liberation from Egypt, later written as the book of Exodus, Numbers, and Leviticus. It was an impressive summary that was eventually written as the fifth book of the Pentateuch, precisely called Deuteronomy, coming from the Septuagint Greek translation of the book, which instead of translating the original, he shall write for himself, it says there, in a book, a copy of this law, placed this second law. That's why it's called Deuteronomy in Greek. However, such title is not altogether inappropriate, this reference to a second, because in fact, the book does contain a recap, as we had just seen. And we read, Moses said to the people, if only you would heed the voice of the Lord your God and keep his commandments and statutes that are written in this book of the law, when you return to the Lord your God with all your heart and all your soul, because they had been straying from the path. They had been whining and complaining. They had been a rebellious lot, hard-headed generation, Moses would call them. Well, he was telling them, if only you return, if only you you would stand fast to these laws that I have given you, the two tablets, remember, that had been given to them 39 years before, because the event of Sinai and the Ten Commandments and all that happened barely a month after leaving Egypt. So can you imagine, you think back a little. What would have happened if instead of making the golden calf, precisely barely a month after leaving Egypt, they were already at the southern tip of the Sinai Peninsula. Took them close to a month to get there. Then just to go up again, the Sinai Peninsula on the other side, because they were skirting the desert in the middle and the wilderness. They were following the coast. So it's like an inverted second arrowhead. Now from Egypt, you go down, if you are following me, it's from east, from west to east, you go down in a south eastern route, and then you go up again, and then you end up in the Promised Land. Then they would have made it in 2 months. Now why 40 years? Precisely because when they were given, at the time of giving them the Ten Commandments, they were in a rebellious, unfaithful, idolatrous mood that made for themselves the golden calf. When Moses was up there talking with God in the Sinai and Mount Sinai and receiving the Ten Commandments, they had fashioned for themselves a golden calf and was doing all kinds of idolatrous behavior, merrymaking, falling into all kinds of adultery as well in the process, getting drunk. And that was how Moses found them. Well, they were punished for that, of course. That generation could not enter the Promised Land. So that whole generation had to die out first. And the next generation were the ones who were going to enter the Promised Land. How do you do that? God led them around the Sinai Peninsula for 40 years before finally arriving in the Holy Land, in the Promised Land. That's the story of the chosen people. And poor Moses, who had always been faithful all his life, had a moment of weakness as well. At Meribah, quite early on in the trip as well. Because the people were complaining, because they were not only hungry, they were thirsty. Because remember, that's the Sinai Peninsula, that's the wilderness, and water was scarce. And that's the reason why, don't think that the holy people, the chosen people, were walking for 40 years. No, they'd encamp where there was an oasis, stay there for a couple of years maybe, until it ran dry, until all the sheep had eaten up all the shrubs and all the grass. And then they'd break camp and go again, being led by God through that pillar of fire by night and that cloud by day. It's like an umbrella for them, that cloud. So wherever it went, they followed it because they'd die otherwise. So it was the shade that was moving for them. And then until they find another oasis or other source of water. And then they'd camp there and stay there for another 2, 3, or even 5 years. And that was how they were. And the last encampment was precisely in Moab. But as I was saying earlier, there was a moment when they were rebelling and Moses was at his wit's end until God told him, okay, get the staff, the same staff of Aaron that had converted the Nile into blood and had parted the waters of the Red Sea. Well, strike the rock once with it and water will come out. But after having struck it once, water didn't gush out immediately. So he struck it a second time. And still, water didn't come out, and struck it a third time. And finally, water came out. And God, Yahweh, took that, imputed that to poor Moses as lack of faith. Oh, my brothers and sisters. Compared to the kind of fidelity that God demanded of his prophets, that God demanded of Peter and the apostles, that he demanded of the early Christians, what we're going through right now is a walk in the park. 2 years of pandemic and people are already losing their heads, making shortcuts in the process, or even forgetting already how to pray properly. Well, let's go on with our reading. So Moses, because of that, was told by God, you shall not enter the Promised Land. And so now in Moab, delivering this great sermon, spoiling the chosen people to be faithful and to implant the kingdom of God in the new land that was being given them, knew very well he was not going to enter it, but he embraced his faith. He did not complain anymore. Mind you, sacred scripture tells us that when Moses passed, he was in the prime of his life. It says if he had gotten weak out of old age, and so therefore was ready to kick the bucket, as they say. No. When he died, scripture says his eyes had not been dimmed, even if he lived more than 100 years. I think he lived to 150. He had not lost any of his teeth. He has a complete set of teeth, and he was in his prime. So why did he die? Because it was his time to die, because they had arrived at the Promised Land, and he was not supposed to enter it. And so he died right there. But anyway, so he was telling them, if only you would heed the voice of the Lord your God and keep his commandments and his statutes that are written in this book of the law when you return to the Lord your God with all your heart and all your soul. For this command that I enjoin on you today is not too mysterious and remote for you. It is not in the sky that you should say, who will go up to the sky to get it for us and tell us of it that we may carry it out. Nor is it across the sea that you should say, who will cross the sea to get it for us and tell us of it that we may carry it out? At this point, you might think, yeah, indeed, because they already had the two tablets, the divine positive law. The natural law is written in the hearts of man. The natural law can be observed from the universe around us. But just in case somebody failed in that, when God constituted the chosen people, he explicitly gave them a summary of the natural law, written in the form of the Decalogue. And so Moses could very well have been telling them at this time, we're reading, that you don't need to search in the sky or across the sea. It's here already in the two tablets, but that's not what he said. Because he said, no, it is something very near to you, already in your mouths and in your hearts. You have only to carry it out. And dear brothers and sisters, here Moses is referring to the natural law, which is the participation of the spiritual creature, the one with intellect and will, in the eternal law of God. That's the language of philosophy. That's the language of the scholastics. That's the language of St. Thomas. What does it mean, a participation? Our appreciation of, our understanding of. So the natural law is man's understanding of the eternal law in God. The grand design for his creation is part of that. And there's a reason why we can fathom it. We can perceive it somehow if we're observant, if we are contemplatives. The natural law is precisely called natural law because it's the law of nature. It's not the law of physical nature, but part of that, that all those physical laws and chemical laws and behavioral laws, et cetera, that scientists think they discover every now and then. No, they don't formulate it. They don't make it. They just precisely discover it, observing nature, because it's there, it's written. It's the design of creation. Well, broaden that a bit more, not just the physical laws anymore or the chemical laws, but rather the nature of man and what is proper of him. What is right and what is wrong? What is in keeping with the nature of things and human nature and what is not? That is the natural law. But as I said, even if that is, in fact, accessible to the human intellect, without any special help from God, the fact is, after original sin, it has become tedious to do it. And what's more, there's no guarantee against error anymore. And that's the reason why humanity had gotten from bad to worse from the time of Adam and Eve. And that's the reason why when the time for salvation, for the redemption came, first God had to prepare a people to receive the Messiah. And that is the whole logic behind the chosen people of Israel. That even if in other things, civilizations, other marks of civilization, engineering, astronomy, chemistry, and all those things, they were far behind their neighbors. They were a bunch of nomads at the time of Moses, more especially the time of Abraham. They were a cut above the rest as far as morality was concerned. And as far as the real nature of things were concerned, what is God, what is the purpose of creation, etc., etc., all of which were revealed to them by God through the prophets, starting with Moses, the constitution of the chosen people with Abraham already, but shall we say perfected at the time of Moses 500 years later, because God gave them the divine positive law, the natural law, revealed by him and etched on stone. But here Moses is telling us in the process, it's not only in stone that it's etched. The natural law is etched in the hearts of men. Not that we're born knowing it, but we're born with an intrinsic inclination to the truth that makes us discover the natural law. in the world, in the universe, in the physical universe around us. And so Moses was telling them, if you only followed this law, if you only followed your intellect, if you only were faithful to the covenant that we had made, because they had made it in the previous years, ratified it in the Sinai, something which was already made by God with Moses and with Abraham, but which again they ratified on the Sinai. If only you did that, then you will be blessed. Herein lies the key to human existence, the path to fulfillment and happiness. Identification with the will of God, who is the author of all creation. In fact, that constituted the very rule of the life of Moses, with a single exception, as we said, a moment of vacillation at Meribah, becoming a reason for his not going beyond Moab into the promised land. Now, let's go to a bit of spiritual sense. The natural law is accessible to man. On top of that, God revealed the divine positive law through the Ten Commandments. And on top of that, because we still failed, sent his only son to redeem us, who established the church with hierarchy, with sacraments, with a leadership who are supposed to shepherd us to our true end, our destiny in heaven. Ergo, it behooves us to open our eyes to that truth and to lead our lives, live our lives rather as God wants. Because that is the formula, that is the root map to our true end. And fortunately, the reverse is also true. If we don't live according to the will of God, if we do not heed the natural law, that in principle, if we open our eyes to reality, we should discover, then what will happen is we're like drivers without a map, or pilots without a navigator. Sure, we can pilot our life, we can run it, you can even run it very fast. But without a true map, without a true guide, like having an instrument without the manual for its use, then we will only misuse it. And that is the phenomenon we see in the world that we're living in. Man misusing his humanity, and thereby giving rise to all manifestations of man's inhumanity to his fellow men. Wars, corruption, slavery, prostitution, abortion. For not to say all these aberrations are happening right now, of choosing and formulating whatever gender you want, regardless of sexuality, because the gender, the LGBTQ agenda, or even changing your sexuality, as if by changing your external organs, you change your sexuality. We cannot change nature, because that's the way God created it. We are not the creators, we're creatures. We are not the designers. We were designed, and it was a perfect design. We have to end. The worst sequel of original sin, after a man straying out of paradise, is the darkness in the intellect that leads him to err as regards the natural law, together with the malice in his will, under the influence of his similarly disordered passions. And this is the so-called fomes peccati, the tinder of sin, the tendency to sin that has bedeviled mankind since the fall of Adam and Eve. How can man rediscover his true destiny and the rightful path to it? How can man recover paradise lost? The answer is Jesus Christ. And this is what St. Paul declares in the second reading taken from his letter to the Colossians, when he says, Christ Jesus is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn of all creation. For in him were created all things, in heaven and on earth, the visible and the invisible, whether thrones or dominions or principalities or powers. All things were created through him and for him. He is before all things, and in him all things hold together. He's the head of the body, the church. He's the beginning, the firstborn from the dead, that in all things he himself might be preeminent. For in him all the fullness was pleased to dwell, and through him to reconcile all things for him, making peace by the wood of the cross through him, whether those on earth or those in heaven. The letter to the Colossians, it's one of the letters which shall be, shall we say, more elevated theology, more difficult, therefore. But once studied closely, you see the full input. It's really theological, of course, it has to be. The author is the Holy Spirit. And it comes down to this. And with this, we shall end. If the whole creation came into being through the word of God, and man divinized by the infusion of the Spirit of God, then fallen man and the whole creation is restored to their original glory by the incarnation of that word. Let's repeat that. If the whole creation came into being through the word, what word is this? Well, the word of God, second person of the Blessed Trinity, man's or God's consubstantial knowledge or idea of himself, and therefore all the other ideas will be contained there too. So if the whole creation came into being through the word of God, and man, who is made to his image and likeness by nature, is divinized by the infusion of the breath of God, the Ruach, that was just moving over the waters of creation, but in the case of man, was breathed into him, making him fully alive, a living being. Then, when man fell, fallen man, and the whole creation that fell with him, because he's on top of creation, so therefore if man is disoriented, he will also wreak havoc on the environment, disorienting it as well. Not destroying it, it's too big for him to destroy, but yes, misusing it. Then fallen man and the whole creation is restored to their original glory by the incarnation of that word. The whole idea of the incarnation, the mystery of the incarnation, is so rich. God elevated man to himself at the dawn of creation, but man went astray. So in order to restore everything, it's not anymore man elevated, because he had already he already blew that, so to speak. So God, who cannot change in his love, went down to our humanity. Without losing his divinity, he gained our humanity. If at the dawn of creation, the, shall we say, the communion between God and man was by the elevation of man to God in the redemption. And we can spend the whole day prostrate on the ground, wondering and giving thanks for this. In the redemption, God abased himself to become man. Will you tell me, a God who does that, is he going to let you go just like that? A God who invested that much, is he going to let his investment go to pot just like that? And that's the reason why, time again, I keep on telling people, it takes talent to go to hell. But unfortunately, many people are very talented and they do it anyway. But if only you and I were to have a minimum of humility, a minimum of, sometimes even say, of intellectual acuity, perspicacity. In other words, use our heads. We should arrive at the conclusion that we have been repeating in these meditations, that you and I are called to holiness, that you and I have a path before us prepared by Jesus Christ. And all we need to do is to follow it. It's not going to be a walk in the park, unfortunately, because original sin has its scars, both in us and in our fellow men. But the path is there. And the wherewithals are there. The nourishment of the sacraments are there. And the leadership is there. If only we open our eyes and not doggedly, hard-headedly stick. Dig in, stick to our own opinions, which is what happens also when people rationalize all kinds of things just to be able to follow or to stay in their comfort zone. We have time. Let's go to our Blessed Mother. In a family, it's always the mother who makes being good, who makes staying together worth it, you know? The mother creates the environment so that people can be generous. They feel loved. They can be generous because they have all their needs satisfied. They feel love and therefore they can love also. They give of themselves because they receive so much from her. But in the church, we have to say the whole universe, we do have a mother. Woman, behold your son. She has taken that mission, that commission very seriously indeed, and will never let go of us, will never let us out of his sight. But alas, we do have a tendency to go astray. Take children. Many times we're just playing. Many times we're just getting distracted, but in fact, we're already going astray. But a good mother goes after her children. A good mother calls and soothes and heals. Let's never get tired of beginning again. Let's never get tired of struggling, because our Blessed Mother will accompany us every step of the way, telling us, whispering to our ears, those sweet words mentioned one fine day in Cana. Do whatever he tells you. Do whatever he tells you. Take a few minutes to formulate your resolutions and finish this prayer on your own.